Okay. Good morning, everyone. Today we are going to arrange one webinar on Able Step and Stable Equilibrium by Dr. Sagar Nayak. Dr. Sagar Nayak is CEO and Chief Physiotherapist, Asian Physiotherapy and Research Center, Surat. He has been working since 2011 in India. And he has work experience in USA also. He has done his master's in motor control and motor learning. And he has 2 years research experience in University of Florida also. So today he will going to put some insights about the how to achieve early mobility, because the stroke will be followed by disability, and this disability will put burden on the caregivers, on the family members. So as a physiotherapist, our main aim is to achieve early mobility or achieve early ambulation. And for ambulation, the stability and mobility both are required. So how to achieve this stability and mobility, that Dr. Sagar Nayak will explain us. Welcome, Dr. Sagar Nayak.
Thank you so much for inviting.
I'm handing over this to you. Thank you, sir.
Definitely. Thank you. So good morning, everybody. So today we'll be discussing about gait rehabilitation in stroke population. So we'll start the presentation. So basically, we'll be discussing about how to gain better walking patterns and balance post-stroke. So first, I'm myself, Dr. Sagar Nayak from Asian Physiotherapy and Research Institute. You can find me on the following locations on Twitter, on Facebook, and my email ID is sagarnayak@apri.in. So if you have any queries, you can write an email on the given ID. So first of all, normally the thank you slides come at the end, but I would like to take it forward, because most of the time, as the webinar goes at the end, many of you might not be there. So I would like to thank the Parul University, Geetika Madam, Chaitali Madam, Milind, and Gaurav sir for providing the platform for me to present over here. And most importantly, thank you all of you who have been connected today. So first is what we know about recovery of lower limb post-stroke. So basically 90% of stroke survivors are left with some functional disabilities. And out of a 100 population, 65 to 85% of the stroke survivors learn to walk independently by almost 6 months. So if that is the case, why we need to talk about gait training and rehabilitation for an hour today? So if people are going to be, almost 85% of the population are going to be independent, then why we want to look at the gait rehabilitation, and why it is given so much importance in stroke rehab? So the walking independently, which has been achieved by 6 months, is it functional walking or meaningful walking? That is a major component of stroke rehab. So what is functional walking or the ambulatory walking? So definition is continuous walk for about 500 meters at a speed of 1.1 to 1.5 meter per second, or If we speak specifically for the stroke population, it's 0.66 to 0.8 meter per second is called functional or meaningful walking post-stroke. That is community ambulation. A person should be able to walk minimum of 500 meters continuously at a stretch, and the speed should be somewhere around 1.1 to 1.5 meter. That is the speed which is required to cross a crossing. So anybody is, if you are ambulatory, community ambulation is required, then you need to cross a road as well. To cross that, normal person requires 1.1 to 1.5 meter per second speed. And if you consider a stroke population, then also a minimum of 0.66 to 0.8 meter per second speed is required to be functionally independent. So let us understand what is 500 meters and what is 0.66 meter per second. It looks very slow, but in reality, what it is. So I will take an example from your institute itself. So if you want to travel from Parul Institute of Business Administration to Central Bank of India, which is at your university itself, it takes, that is 500 meters walk, which is about walking 1,640 steps, which requires 5 minutes to walk continuously to reach Central Bank of India. That is 500 meters walk. So for normals like you and me, it's very easy. But when we talk about stroke population, it's very cumbersome and difficult to walk 1600 steps at a stretch without stopping, which is the requirement for a community ambulation. And if you go towards Parul Institute of Physiotherapy, that is where you all are, majority of you are studying, it requires 8 minutes to walk, and that is 615 meters. So this is about how much distance. Now we talk about what is the speed. So same example, you start from Parul Institute of Physiotherapy and you reach towards Dhiraj Hospital. So that is 1.5 meter per second speed that you need to cover this distance in 1 hour. 5 kilometers you need to walk at us in 1 hour, then the speed is 1.5 meter per second. So this is the speed of walking which is required to achieve or to be ambulatory on a road where you might have to do a crossing a road during this speculated time period. That is the time frame where the lights are on and off. So when we define this, and the stroke population is very difficult to achieve that particular speed, people have done a lot of research and found out that 0.66 to 0.8 is also a valid speed at which they might be able to communicate at most of the places except for road crossings. And that speed is walking from Parul Institute of Physiotherapy till Sri Dutt Petrol Pump, which is on your main road. That is walking 1 kilometer, walking 2.2 kilometers in 1 hour. That is the speed at which you need to, a stroke population should be able to walk to be functionally independent and ambulatory walking. So let's ask an example. Out of 65 to 85% of population who are walking independently, are they functional walkers? No. Only 7% of those population are community level ambulators. So only 7% of them are ambulatory. So that's why it is important that we keep more focus on gait rehabilitations, new techniques, how we can improve gait speed and patterns of stroke population. Another factor is most of those community level ambulators, 70% of them have fall histories. So that is very problematic area. That is the balance is affected. And out of this 70% population, 50% of the population are such, they are fall or they lose balance while walking itself. So that is the major component, or why today we are going through this particular webinar on gait rehabilitations, that is stable able steps, that is it's more able, and stable equilibrium, the getting more balance while walking, so that they can be more functional and useful for their daily activities. The similar example is for upper extremity as well. People gain shoulder flexion, abduction and everything, but if they don't have fine movements, it's of no use. Similarly, you are walking, but if you are not at a community level ambulators, it's of no use. You won't be able to go anywhere, right? So the next two slides are more about the basics of how the gait is controlled and the biomechanics of gait. I'm not going to go much into detail about that. I have given the references of from where I have taken this details. So you can go through that and have a brush up of your gait patterns. So locomotion is a complex process. It involves cerebral cortex, cerebrum, cerebellum, your midbrain areas, basal ganglia, and most important, another most important and neglected factor is your spinal support network. That is your central pattern generators. Keep a very close look at that particular segment as well, because this is the one of the components which we miss during our rehabilitation protocols. I will talk about that particular segment in our later talks when I talk about gait rehabilitation techniques, why this is important and why speed is a component where you need to focus much more. Another external parameters are your vestibular systems, your proprioceptives, and your visual systems also is a complex process with which you move or you are able to walk. The diagram is taken from the reference I have already mentioned. You can go through the entire neurophysiological of gait details over there. Now, talking about gait, biomechanics of gait. So, this is the basic gait cycle. 60% of is the gait cycle is stance phase, and 40% is your swing phase. And both stance and swing phase are divided into different parameters, which you already know. I'm not going to go much of, in the detail of the biomechanics of gait, but I will at the end summarize where all the factors people with stroke have problems in different gait patterns, right? So pathological gait patterns in stroke. The next 4-5 slides are more from the research point of view and from what people are doing to understand gait mechanics. So at times, those slides might be difficult to understand, but I will give at the end this summary of what it concludes, or on each slide I've mentioned what is the meaning of that particular slide and what is the crux for you to understand. Okay, so the first is the modular controls of gait. So basically, people have divided the muscle groups which work together in different phases in one different modules. So they have divided into 5 modules that any person, me, you, or a stroke person, they work on 5 components. The module 1, that is more of gluteus medius, rectus femoris. Module 2 is soleus gastrocnemius. Module 3, rectus femoris tibialis anterior. Module 4 is hamstrings, and module 5 is iliopsoas. The details are over here. I can share the details on emails if you require the more detailed factors. But more important factor is, normally you, me, work more on 4 or 5 modules while walking. That is the normal patterns. But when we talk about stroke, they use very fewer modules. Most of the stroke patients use 2 or 3, maximum 3 modules to walk. But what does that mean? So basically, if you look at over here, I mentioned only most of the almost 45 to 50% populations with stroke are only using 2 modules. About 40 another person are using almost the basically 3 modules. So if you combine 2 and 3, almost 80% of the population are using only 2 or 3 modules of walking. What does that mean? Fewer modules means more muscle co-activations. So basically, patients are walking with co-activation patterns. That is like basically antagonists and agonists are working together. They are working in a synergy and walking. So that is more cost of energy is there. And they are not able to produce a proper symmetrical walking pattern. So this is the factor. This one and this one are the issues where basically they are working with the more co-activation patterns. But when the population are more high functioning, they work with more modules, that is about almost 4 modules together. And that is more of a greater locomotor complexity. That is, they are able to generate isolated symmetrical movement patterns, and they are able to ambulate more. So basic for modular controls, more factor is, if you are more affected, that is more to moderate to severely affected populations are working with fewer modules, and the people who are highly functioning, they are working with greater modules. Okay. Again, the references have been mentioned. So the next is looking at the EMG levels. That is also a very important factor while understanding or doing a gait rehabilitation. Most of the time we are focusing on the gait rehabilitation, but important factors are where the muscle has to activate. And that has been missed from the rehabilitation part, and we just train the movements. But that is not important. You need to emphasize on the timing of movement pattern initiation. That is also very important. So The ear is the healthy subject where the muscle activity happens, and this is the hematopoietic subject. So during this time, tibialis anterior is almost down, but when you talk about the hemiparetic patients, it's highly active. Similarly, gastrocnemius has a spike very initially. The timing of vastus, the rectus muscle, has to be early, but in stroke patient, it is delayed. And major component is the glutes, which are the stabilizers of your leg, are completely zero, or it's very less activity. And that hampers your gait patterns. So what is the crux of this particular slide is, you need to focus on your gluteus muscles a lot, because that is the most stabilizing muscle, which will provide stability while walking. And with that only, you will be able to move much more easier and much more in a proper systematic manner. And the second is right time activation of your vastus muscle. That will provide you the gait pattern and symmetry of walking. So these are also components which are required when you are training a gait patient, stroke patients. So this is important factors, but normally in clinical rehabilitation, I am also a clinician. Most of the time, we don't look at these particular factors. We try to train glutes, but in a normal position. But does it activating during walking? That is very, very, very important. And that link is normally missing, right? So the next is range of motion. Again, this the graphical presentation is just for the understanding. You don't understand, that's okay. I will just brief up all those things. But major important factor is what we are using on those different parameters. Initially about the modules, muscle activations, muscle EMG levels. Now coming on to the gait patterns, that is from range of motion. What people are using with stroke patients. So the dark lines are the normal population, and the crooked lines are the stroke population that is affected, and one is unaffected leg. So if you look at, they are using very less amount of ankle, knee, and hip movements. The range of motion is very less in those populations compared to the normals. In the contrary, they are using more of a pelvic controls. So like basically they are doing the hiking, maybe the circumduction is there. The pelvic movements are more of seen, and they are more used while the patient is walking. So we need to concentrate on reducing the pelvic movements and improving the ankle, knee, and hip movements. That is the crux of for this particular slide. Right. So the next is, we are given there are different kinds of patients. If you take two similar locations of stroke, then also the clinical presentation might differ. So people have tried to divide them in different subgroups. So basically that is fast walkers, moderate walkers, slow extended walkers, and slow flexed walkers. So what does that mean? So basically fast walkers are independent walkers. They have almost 45% normal speed, what a normal human person has, but there is a lack of heel strike, and there is hyperextension of knee present. So basically quadriceps and hamstring control is not greatest in this particular population group, but they are highly functional population which are independent, and they are community at the to a certain extent they are moving community in community as well. The second group is the moderate walkers. Again, those are independent walkers, but their walking speed is almost 50% less than the previous group. They have excessive hip and knee flexion movements. That is mainly because of tight plantar flexors. They are not able to clear the ground much. So they compensate using excessive hip and knee flexion. So that is more of a high stepping gait. Weakness of glutes and rectus increases compared to your fast walkers. The third group is slow extended walkers. They require assistive devices to walk. Their speed is about 11% normal speed to the when they are compared with the normal group population. Their hip hiking is very predominant. Circumductory of leg is present. There is more increase in plantar flexors, and hyperextension of knee is more. And the another group is the slow flex walkers. They are very they require a lot of assistance. Their speed is less than 10% of normal speed. The strength limitation of at hip, knee, and ankle is very high, that there it is very limited. and trunk forward leaning is increased, and knee remains in flexion while walking as well. This is the group where there is lack of activation of quadriceps in the end range of the quadriceps muscle. That is the vastus medialis, VMO is not functioning much. So that creates the group where it is always the patients are walking with knee flexed only. So people have divided into these four different group of walkers, where they define what are the factors which might be affected in these particular groups and what would be the prognosis of this kind of populations. You can make out from these details. So to summarize, what are the pathological conditions, all the things what I've mentioned in last four or five slides, is what all things you've seen and where they are affecting. That I've made a correlation which would be much more easier for you to understand. That is decreased hip extension at the end of stance. So when you, that is more of a standing on one leg, that hip extension, that is the importance of your gluteus muscle. Decrease hip flexion in mid swing. So when swinging your leg, there is hip knee flexion is required and that is affected. Decrease knee flexion at toe off and mid swing. Again, knee flexion is also limited. Decrease ankle dorsiflexion at foot. That may be because of your tightness in your calf, and that creates an associated movement which is hyperextension of your knee. So on your foot, your tibia cannot come 90 degree perpendicular. Because your calf is tight, you are not able to achieve normal dorsiflexion at your knee. And that creates hyperextension of your knee because of the torsion what you get at your knee joint, because your tibia cannot come forward. Decrease ankle plantar flexion at toe off. This is also very important, which we normally miss. We think that ankle plantar flexors, that is the basically soleus and gastroc, are tight. And we think that it is basically more stronger as well, but that is wrong. They don't have a good push off. Stroke patients don't push off very nicely. That is because of weakness of your soleus and gastroc. This is another very important point which we miss in rehabilitation. You see very high functioning patients also, but their walking pattern is altered because they don't have a strong push off. That is the weakness. I will talk more about this particular point in the treatment part, that is on strengthening components and how much we are using the strength component in our rehabilitation. Increased knee flexion at foot contact, that is more from the perspectives of those high functioning patients where the foot that is limited ankle movement. So they need to compensate with your hip knee more flexion. When we talk about kinematics or spatiotemporal parameters, they are decreased walking speed. That is the most commonly seen. Short and uneven step and stride lengths, increased stride width, and increased double support phase and dependent on support through the hands. Normally, they try to find someone to hold on to walking. So these are the basic components where basically people with stroke have problems with. So we'll be incorporating these all factors and how to increase or improve these components through our rehabilitation protocols. So the treatment concepts. Before I begin with the treatment concepts, there are tons and tons of literature and tons of different techniques which have been there in literature to improve gait and balance. But still today, each and every technique has its own limitations and advantages. Most of the stroke rehabilitation is still unclear, as in upper limb, lower limb is also not that very clear that this technique was better than the other is not always true. So we'll start with more traditional components, treatment approaches, and then move towards the more complex and more advanced techniques which are currently being used and trialed in research and in clinical practice as well. During this, I will be putting points of what people as a clinician, me as a clinician, what all problems do I face during the treatment protocols and how we incorporate this treatment approaches in clinical practice so that it is much more easier for us to make our stroke patients more community ambulatory, right? So first we'll start with, and before that, most important factor. This slide is little abruptly kept, but it is more important because for all the treatment approaches, this is the principle of neuroplasticity, which is most important. Use it or lose it. You need to use it, otherwise you will lose that function. Use it and improve it. You need to use it repeatedly so that it improves specificity. The training which you are giving has to be very specific. Repetition does matter, and that is the intensity and the repetitions is very, very important in stroke rehab. And most of the time in clinical practice, what we have seen is people lack over here. The repetitions and the intensity is so less that it does not improve this function. And that's why the first five parameters are very important in all of the parameters. What all treatment approach you are adopting, Bobath, Brunstorm, or your PNF, or your body weight support training, or FPS, or whatever it is, you name it, whatever it is, you should be focusing on all these components, and mainly first five. It has to be repetitive and intensive. Intensive in both the factors, it should put a load on the patient, and it has to be repeatedly done. Right. So first, starting with the neurofacilitation techniques, that is Bobath neurodevelopmental therapy, Brunstrand approach, which uses resistance but does and also the associated reactions to improve the patient. Proprioceptive neuromuscular facilitation techniques, that is they use resistance to facilitate movement, but only resistance is provided. As such, abnormal movement patterns are not generated. That is the important factor. More details you can find in adult Bobath, adult hemiplegia book of Bobath, and the different articles of the Brunstrom and proprioceptive neuromuscular facilitation. I'm not going to go into detail about the approaches and physiological parameters on which this treatment approaches work, because that's a completely different talk process. I'm just going to supervise you on which all different techniques, facilitations, and inhibitory techniques which would be useful for you to work while treating your stroke patients, to just give you overview of different factors and how this can be utilized in a clinical practice. So this is from the Bobath. It's about training your knee movements. The first image, it's starting, that is the initial factor in which you train your knee and hip, knee flexion and extension movements for your walking parameters. This is the requirement to get a proper gait patterns. And normally in stroke patients, you don't get much of your hamstrings activity that is most effective. So you need to initiate that particular activity very initially. And this is one of the techniques. If you put hip in your extension position, and then try to activate your hip, knee flexion and extension, it's a better chances of getting activations of your hamstring. Hamstring here is gravity assisted. So with your hand, what you will do is you will resist that particular movement to activate your hamstring activity. And for your knee, isolated knee control, which is very important in stroke patients, would be initiated in this particular training. Once the patient adopts this particular activity, you can progress to the wall slide. The patient's foot is kept on the wall and hip would be in the little bit of rotated position so that your hikers are not activated. It's completely relaxed because of the stretch position. And keeping your control of your hip, you need to slide your leg down and up to gain control of your knee. Now, if the patient is not having much of your control on your hip, you can assist over here, and then you can try to enhance this particular component. Once you get a little bit of more control, you can reduce your supports what you are giving to the patients. So this is the facilitative techniques what you can achieve while keeping in point that the extensor chain, which is more synergistic pattern in lower limb, without activating that particular channel. So normally when you put this particular position, what patient would try to do, if your command is, you should not be, your leg should not fall. If that is the command, what the patient would do is, he would press the leg into the wall. So what happens that when you're pushing it, you are activating the entire extensor chain, and that hampers your isolated movements. That will trigger the spasticity of your extensors, of your lower limb. And that has to be not be done. What focus would be here? Your leg should not slide, and you need to just hold your leg in this particular position. That would be the command, rather than pushing the leg onto the wall. This is one of the techniques for your hip knee control movements. Mainly when you talk about any of your neurofacilitation or motor control segments, MOBART techniques is also evolving as we are moving ahead. They have adapted lot many principles of motor control. It also, this everything is based on your control, how you are controlling your movement patterns, how your brain is involving these particular activities. These activities has to be active. You cannot do passive movements. Passive activities does not activate any of your brain controls, and it won't help you with any movements. You won't be able to get good activity post-stroke. So always try to enhance. Yeah, you can give assistance, but it should not be a passive. Passive rehabilitation does not activate your brain circuits, right? So it has to be active. Another technique is for gaining weight bearing. And again, the control of your knee, hip is facilitated over here. The patient is right hemi. How to initiate weight bearing on your left, on your right leg? The unaffected leg, which is left in this case, would be supported. The patient would be halfly coming down. The buttocks region would be continuously supported with your bed. And the patient would put the weight, try to extend the knee, and would try to get up. Again, he can take the support of the plinth in initial phases. Once that is better, you can move away from the bed, and the patient would be able to control the knee. You need to focus on the knee, because there are huge chances that it would go in hyperextension. If that is the case, you need to assist or give feedback with touch at your knee, as the therapist is doing in this particular case. If you want to enhance more, you can put a table over here, so that the weight bearing is over here and the full weight bearing is on the affected side. Right? Another technique is gaining sit to stand. This is a very important strategy which has to be enhanced to get a very independent walking. When we talk about walking, it's not always walking, but the transfers. Let's say, for example, you achieved walking, but the patient is not able to stand by himself. It's no point of gaining walking. That is the important component of gaining walking patterns and sit to stand activity. With proper training of sit to stand, what will happen is the weight bearing on your affected side. Here is left side hemiparesis. The leg should always be in front or at the level of the unaffected leg. Normally, this is not the case when you see a stroke patient stand up. What would happen is the unaffected leg is behind, so that the patient is putting the entire weight on the unaffected side and the patient is standing up. That is the wrong pattern what you are generating. So from the first day itself, you need to concentrate a lot on keeping the legs in equal level. That it has to be at the level, or affected leg should be behind the unaffected leg. That is more challenging. You can progress in sit to stand by this particular method. Another missing component while sit to stand is they don't come forwards. The patient tends to stand up while they are backwards. Again, you are not putting your center of gravity within your foot to stand up. And that is the missing component in your stroke patients. Whatever stroke patients you see, this is very commonly seen. Even with high functioning stroke patients, they don't take body forwards because of fear of fall. So that has to be taught very initially. This is like treating a patient when after a 2 or 3, 4 days, 5 days post-stroke, you can start this particular training if they have a little bit of good balance of sitting balance. If not, then also it's very important to train early with assistance. Right. And then once the weight is forward, you need to activate your glutes and quadriceps to lift your body up. So this is the sequence in which a person should train standing, sit to stand activity. So there are three components. First is the foot, second is forward bending, and the third is initiation of quads and glutes to lift up. Now, if your glutes and quads activity is low, you can increase the height of your stool or the chair so that you are compensating that with your height of the adjustment so that patient can at least lift himself. Otherwise, what would happen? Patient won't lift and it is not meaningful. You are just attempting to do a sit to stand, but patient is not able to fulfill. That is not functional. So that's why it's very important that you train or you design an activity which is more functional, and at the end of the activity, patient feels accomplished, that patient has achieved something. And for that, you need to continuously evaluate that what all the parameters are affecting and how much I can give assistance, or assistance can be as a height adjustment, the support what you are giving, and complete the task. Also, putting a load on the patient. So this is a complex process, but you should be continuously working with the patient. And most of the time when we train this sit to stand or different activities in clinical practice, what people see is therapist is standing in next to the patient and patient is doing the activity. The patient would be doing wrong. So you need to be continuously giving verbal, visual, and the touch. Touch is a very important component when you treat stroke patients. Where to assist, where to resist, all depends on your touch, right? Another is inhibitory technique. The affected leg again is left one, and left, once you do a cross leg sitting, like normally females do normally this side of sitting activity, this inhibits your spasticity activity. That is an important component of inhibition of your lower spasticity. I won't go much into the details. Here also you can incorporate with motor control, doing knee extension and flexion movements, lifting your affected leg slightly up, that is hip flexion, and putting it down. Again, not pressing it down, because gravity would be pulling your leg down. You need to control your leg and put the leg down. That is the commands what you train with motor control concepts. And that are the important components. Again, if you gravity would help in assisting, but if you the patient push the legs down, it would again activate your extensor activity, extensor spasticity of your lower limb, which should not be happening in any of these approaches. Moving, I was very lucky to find this particular article from 1967. It defines the entire proprioceptive neuromuscular facilitation techniques in stroke and cerebral palsy population. Very nicely done. I won't go much into details, but again, this is more of stabilization, counter stabilization techniques, which you use, reciprocal inhibition techniques, which you use in PNF. And patterns, the extensor in this, the affected leg is the left one. You need to activate the left extensors, abductors, and your dorsiflexors before you your right leg goes into a swing phase. And that has been counteracted by the trunk, forward flexion, and the resistance from the therapist. However, as I mentioned before, none of the neurofacilitation approaches have shown significant improvements in performance of activities of daily living or walking performance after stroke. But does that mean all these treatment approaches are not useful? I won't say that. But the major component is why research is not able to trace those improvements. It's because lack of, there are many factors, that is the lack of documentation, the progressive effort of treatment. You cannot define, like for example, I was giving resistance in sit to stand activity. How you will define that? So the treatment part is not properly defined in this particular segments. Second is variability of trials, time duration. All those factors are hampering research to find the improvements in this particular techniques. But as a clinician, we use a lot of these techniques along with more proven techniques. So it's always a combination of approaches what you use when you work with stroke patients. So moving ahead, this strength training program. Normally, what belief normal people have, when I returned from US, I had did many sessions on many seminars on strength training program in stroke. I've written articles as well in Physio Times and all, but there is still, I would say, there is people are not accepting this concept a lot. American Stroke Association defined that you need to do strength training programs for your stroke patients regularly, at least 2 to 3 days per week, to improve your gait patterns as well. And that important factor is it should be at 50 to 80% of your one RM. So normally, are physiotherapists doing strength training in clinical practice for stroke? I don't think so. Major factor is whatever level of work what we are doing in normal clinical practice, like doing a walking training or maybe basically lifting a little bit of weights while quadriceps strengthening activity, the weight what you're putting is very low. Here, what I mentioned, while intensity, resistance, and your strength program in previous slides, this is the catch, that we are not training our stroke patients at that particular intensity where it is required to get optimal results. So our training is basically very low, that you don't see a lot of improvements given your spontaneous recovery. After your spontaneous recovery is gone, you don't see much of improvement in your stroke patients because we are not training the patients hard. And why we are not doing that? That has also been researched, and major components are inability of clinical practitioners to work at 50 to 80% of one RM. One RM, you know that maximum weight you can lift for one repetition. You need to train a patient, stroke patients, at 50 to 80% of your one RM. And you need to do 8 to 10 repetitions for that particular muscle groups. And we, 90% of our clinicians don't do at this particular level. Again, it has been discouraged from traditional approaches like Bobat, Brunstrom and all, that if we increase the strength programs, it will increase spasticity. But that is completely wrong. It has been proved that strength training does not increase spasticity. There are tons and tons and tons of literature available for that. Another notion in Indian context is spastic muscles, tight muscles are strong muscles, but that is completely wrong again. Those are also weak muscles. Again, this is the component when I mentioned about the tightness of calf. We don't concentrate or we don't train push-off, calf strengthening. High-functioning patients, they are very lacking with push-off. And because of that, they have high stepping gait because that push-off is affected. So you need to train spastic muscles as well for strength. Fear of adverse effect, that if I train at this particular level, patient might be having some cardiac issues and he might faint or he might get another stroke, but that is not there. There are hardly a study which have proven that patient has lost his life because of strength training. You can find any, you can go through many literatures and it's not there. Another factor is increasing musculoskeletal pain. If I do a very vigorous strength training program, patient might be having pain. When we talk about strength training for lower extremity, maybe knee pain, but that is also not true because recommendations for OA are similar to what the recommendations are there for strength training for stroke patients. So both are similar programs. Then if it was to increase in OA patients, then how it should be increased in stroke patients, right? So all these parameters are not true. And I would definitely put a very good recommendations that every clinicians or you being a students, you need to practice proper strength training programs for your stroke patients to improve their walking capabilities, walking patterns, and also your make them more functional and more faster in walking, right? So this is one of the neglected components of stroke rehab in Indian context. Foreign people are starting to do in these particular segments, but still not up to the mark. But our population is almost nil. None of the clinicians are practicing strengthening programs, or very few, as per my knowledge. So the next is task specific gait training. So this can be in two forms. One is gait training on treadmills, that is with or without harness, depending on the functionality of the patients. And the another component is circuit training kind of thing, like doing different activities repeatedly on different surfaces. Again, the major difference in these two techniques is the repetitions. In this, there is always limitation of repetitions. You cannot repeat the task over and over in this particular segment, because the patient is doing at his own space. And if he's tired, he won't continue, he won't stretch. But that is the advantage on treadmills. The treadmills, the lower surface is moving, so patient has to put an effort to continue walking till you stop the machine. So this is more accepted for repetitions. Normally, to change your brain circuits, you require to walk minimum of 700 to 800 steps at a stretch to change your neuroplasticity, to make a good pattern in your brain. This is the requirement. So do you think when you do a gait training in a parallel bar, can you make the patient walk for 700 steps? That is almost walking from Parul Institute of Administration to Parul Institute of Physiotherapy. That much distance has to be walked at a stretch or in one session to make some changes, positive changes in your brain. It's not possible in your parallel bars. So for that purpose, the advanced technologies have come in, where the treadmills, which would help you, or robotic devices, which will help you to gain that particular repetitions in a shorter time duration and to change the gait patterns or the higher circuits. So that is one of the advantages of this particular systems. Another factor is when you unway the patients, these are the clinical factors and clinical things which you need to understand. I think Parul, your institute also have got now unwaying systems, I guess. How much to unload? That is also very important. If you are unloading more than 50%, no point of doing unwaying trainings. You need to be, yeah, for initial purpose, it's okay. But patient should be weight bearing. Your gravitational force should be acting on your muscles, your body, so that the muscles activate. Otherwise, it would be more of a robotic or a basically passive walk. Your muscles won't be activated that much, mainly your gluteus, because you are completely off your legs. So that is also very important. Ideal is 15 to 30% of the unweighing is acceptable. People normally starts at 30% of the unweighing and then slowly gradually reduce to zero. 15% has shown that 15% of body weight unweighing provides better gait patterns and also the forces on your joints as well. So that is the most appropriate guidelines from body weight support literature. Right. So all again, pros and cons are there. Literature still hasn't find much of a transfer of activity. So walking on a treadmill is not similar to walking on a ground. So you need to combine both these approaches together to gain more transfer of activity, that is transfer of function. So you train walking over here, but if you are not at what you walk. Again, here comes your neural control segments. Walking, yes, they have a higher control, has a control on your spinal segments, but walking is very automated. You don't think and walk. But in stroke patients, patients think and walk, and that's why they are slow walkers. So with treadmills, what you can do is you can make them walk at faster speeds, which you cannot do in normal gait. They will be walking at your normal speed only, but here you can push them. We have seen, I don't have videos, but we have seen so many patients that they gain very normal walking speed at a higher speeds. That is like 3.5 to 4 to 5 kilometer per hour speed. They are very normal in walking patterns. I'm working from home, so I don't have those videos, but if anybody is interested, I can share those videos with you to see how much change you get in that walking patterns. With fast walking, what happens is the brain higher control doesn't involve in thinking process. and your normal central pattern generators are activated to get a normal automated walking function. But again, you need to do this activity very repeatedly to see that change in your ground walking. Again, transfer of activity is required, right? So this is all about task specific gait training, which can be body weight supported and functional circuit kind of a training. Always advisable is to have both of them together. I won't recommend either of one to which would give you better results. So it has to be intensive training with many repetitions. That is possible with your body weight support. Goals should be improving endurance, functional strengthening, balance challenges, and varying speed requirements. This again incorporates a lot of motor learning principles as well. That is depending on how much you are challenging and how much concepts or assistance you are giving during the gait training programs. So the next is, again, functional electrical stimulation. It has been used in literature since 1960s, but still there is a lot of lack of evidence of its effectiveness. Again, it has shown effectiveness only and only when they are combined with other treatment approaches like body weight support treadmill or treadmill trainings, or with while walking the stimulation is given along with strengthening programs. It has shown good results. So this is the patient with foot drop and dorsiflexes are being activated. There is still pattern is not appropriate because of the lack of speed. If I increase the speed, the pattern would be much more faster. I didn't have that particular video, but it is possible to get a very good patterns, proper hip knee flexion, and with little bit of more activation of your dorsiflexes with FES. When I talk about stimulations, normally in our clinical practice, we don't have all those functional electrical stimulations or EMG based stimulators, because it was costlier ones. But the practice of passive stimulations is completely wrong. You should not be giving passive stimulations to stroke patients. It's not going to activate any of your brain circuits. Yeah, for muscle property levels, that's okay. But it would be much more useful if you are doing it with active participation. So the patient should put an effort to activate the muscle. The current, if you are giving directly to the patient, it would be not useful to the patient. Many of the times, in most of the clinical practice, what people do is for dorsiflexes, they put electrodes, the leg is coming up like this, and time is gone. Patient is completely in a mobile or something, or thinking something else. If you are not activating your, trying to activate your muscle group, it is of no use. Again, you should be very cautious with stimulations when you are working with left hemis. Left hemis means right hemisphere damage, and your left side hemiparesis is there. They are lacking. Most of the left hemis have sensory issues, and we miss this component and we see blisters or burns because of the stimulations. What we generally use is electrical stimulation. Yeah, if you're using functional electrical stimulations or EMG biofeedback or any NMES, neuromuscular electrical stimulation, you won't be getting, because the current is continuously alternating. But with the normal stimulators, it will definitely give you burns. So don't use those in left hemis, right? And we always, with your normal stimulation, you can do active participated stimulations, but you need to be there with the patient. The command would be, first try to do the activation of your dorsiflexes. He's trying to put an effort. You can do reinforcement with the unaffected leg dorsiflexor. And then you see a little bit of activation, you can palpate. And if you see some movement, you can then increase the intensity to gain the movement. So that is, with normal stimulation, you can do EMG or a little bit of more of a sophisticated active participated dorsiflexor or stimulation, which would be useful for the patient. But passive stimulation is not recommended in stroke patients, at least for preserving your muscle property, that's okay. But I don't think, if you are making the patient ambulate very quickly, I don't think you require passive stimulations. Moving more advanced technologies which are coming up is robotic gait trainings. Again, in this, there are two types of therapies. One is the locomats, that is more of exoskeleton based. That is your entire body, from your trunk, your foot, is completely supported and you do a gait training. And another is a little bit of more challenging, that is more of an any factor, that is you have supposed you are binded through a robot only from the foot. Your entire body is not completely locked down. So you have more degrees of movement over here compared to over here. Again, both these systems have pros and cons. And again, getting the systems are very costly. It's in crores. So it's difficult to do that. But with basic unwing systems, you can do wonders. These systems work according to that only. Yeah, it has an effect. In this kind of systems, you can do what is the requirement, 702,000 steps in only 20 minutes in these systems. Because it can assist, it can active, the patient can do by himself. If the patient is not able to produce that much of force, then the system can assist the movement and it can be passive as well when in very flaccid cases. Again, passive ones are not recommended in this particular systems also. Right. Next is the aquatic gait trainings for stroke. Research have shown that people with stroke, this is a left hemi patient walking in water. Again, I didn't have much of the videos, but again, and this patient was with tube because she was very afraid of walking. Otherwise, normally, if you don't use tubes, it would be much more useful because the patient is a little bit of more floating over here and you are not putting much of effort on your limbs. Research have shown that gait training in aquatics, treadmill training, again, opposite to the water currents, it helps you increase your strength and you're improving the gait parameters like speed and also the kinematics. That is very, very important over here, that you can change the gait patterns while training patients in water. That has been proven, and those all literatures are very recent ones, 19th and 20. So it is again one of the novel approaches which commonly we are not using in our clinical practice, but it is highly recommended that people use these techniques to get proper gait patterns, to improve the gait patterns of stroke patients. Now, next couple of slides are more to do with recent advances or what people are doing innovatively for gait rehabilitation and for gait training. So one recent studies are doing turning based gait training. So again, it's very difficult to get in our practice, but this is for the what upgradations or people are trying to do with the gait rehabilitation. These studies have shown that people walking continuously turning activity is increasing more cortex activity in your frontal, parietal and temporal regions than compared to your straight line walking. They have done some EMG, EEG studies and also fMRI studies where they, during the training, they see the activations of your brain. And they have found out that it is much more active compared to your straight walking. Again, how feasible it is in clinical practice, it's a question mark. And maybe in next 5 to 10 years, there might be some treadmills which have this kind of parameters if it has been proven more effective. Now research is more going towards virtual rehab. So people have started creating scenes where they are immersing people in some community task and do some training. So like for example, they need to make a little bit of turn, they need to do a little bit of sideways walk. That is with treadmill trainings, unwing systems, and virtual rehab. Again, virtual rehab is very, very important and is gaining a lot of advantages in rehabilitation. We are already using virtual rehabs. That is, it's not a virtual, but it is at least visual feedbacks. That is what you are giving. Now we are making it more virtual, that patients are getting those things, what they would be doing in normal outside community, that can be practiced in-house, which is an important factor, and research is moving along these particular lines. Similarly, what we are doing today is like similar. I might have come to Parul University and given you a lecture, but now it's more virtual, that I'm sitting at my home and you all are sitting at your home and listening to this particular webinar. So these are the concepts which are happening all over the world and different approaches which have been there. I have tried to incorporate few of the clinical factors where we make mistakes or we are not, as the clinicians are not giving effort on that particular points during the entire talk. And to summarize the entire, yeah, and one of the most important factor of gait training is, what is this? This is what the patient was asked to do. And patient did this. Patient was asked to draw this and patient did this. What is this? This is another very commonly seen parameters in stroke patients, and this affects your gait a lot. And we normally don't give focus on this particular segment. That is this visual spatial neglect, or the neglect of the, it can be personal, that the patient is not aware of about his or half side of the body which is paralyzed, or it can be extra personal, that is he's not visualizing that particular component of his environment. Mainly this is seen with left hemis, again left hemiparesis, right brain damage, that is non-dominant part is with this particular segments. We had one patient, I'm sorry, I'm not having that particular video. We had a patient, completely functional patient, is walking very normal gait pattern. If you see, without any obstacles in the field, the patient is walking, you won't be able to make out that the patient has got a stroke. Patient came to us at 3 months. The complaint was, patient chalta chalta darwaja ma thokai jai chhe. That was the complaint of the patient. When we evaluate that particular patient, it was that he didn't had the left sensory inputs, left awareness of the body. He was not recognizing the part of that particular left environment. And that's why he was not ambulatory, or he was not community functional. He was having the speed. He was having the, what I would say, the 5 meters, 500 meters walking requirements, but he was not having the perception of his left side. And because of that, their family members were not able to leave him alone, because he would just smash anywhere. We did some videos, like one half door was open, he just blind his left side of his shoulder with the door, the right passed away. So it was like this, and it dropped and it was turning. So he didn't appreciate that. For that, you need to be very focused. 80% of your left hemis have some kind of neglect. 70 to 80% of left hemis have some kind of neglect. They are very poor with dual tasks, left hemis. So these are the components which you need to understand when you are treating stroke patients. There are differences in your left and right hemiparetic differences. As with right hemis, you have speech deficits and all. With left hemis, you have visual issues. You need to train scanning of your in dark rooms. You need to have laser lights and you need to scan the activity. Your right eye has to be closed so that they track that. Okay, this is, they get the perception of moving your left side, doing left movements. Your right hand need to appreciate the left side of the body and the midline activities. These all are very commonly seen in your left hemis. So with left hemis, if you're not getting results, try to look at the sensory motor components of stroke, perceptive deficits, visual deficits. If it's a cerebellar dysfunction, cerebellar stroke, that is only 7 to 10% of the patient population, what you see in the entire stroke population, they have hemianopia. You need to address that particular segment as well. Otherwise, whatever you have achieved, you won't be seeing differences in your gait patterns. So these are the common factors which you, as a therapist, one should be aware of in treating stroke patients for rehab. So to summarize, neurophysiological and motor learning techniques are not specifically focused on gait rehabilitation. That's okay. Body weight support treadmill training has moderate evidence to improve walking and motor recovery. Functional electrical stimulation combined with different walking retraining strategies improve hemiplegic gait. But above all is the combination of different rehabilitation strategies seem to be more effective than the normal gait trainings what we do. So it's always a combination of all the strategies together and to come with a proper rehabilitation program. Again, it has to be intensive, challenging, and repetitive to be more functional. Your training is more functional and is more, it will give you more results. That has to be done. So these are the parameters of the stroke patients when you treat stroke patients. So thank you all again for inviting me and listening me. I don't know how we can have the question sessions. I don't know that. But if you have any questions, I would repeat my email ID. It's sagarnayak@apri.in. Ma'am, over to you.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your insight. You have started with the Bobart's concept, and you have also covered the recent advances which are already in practice and which may emerge in India in near future also. So very good coverage for the GATE training. I'm very sure that this will be definitely helpful for the student also and for the practitioner also to implement this practice and improving the GAIT and function of the patient in future. So thank you once again from Faculty of Physiotherapy, Parul University, for sparing your time and providing very important insights for the GAIT rehabilitation to all the members who have attended this webinar. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Governor.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Khub saras webinar ato. Much informative to students.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Take care. Bye.
Yeah. Bye. Bye, sir.